It's the Forensic Lunch. I'm Dave. With me, hopefully always, is Matthew.
Well, hello.
And this by week, I don't know, this episode, this broadcast, I'm not even going to try to put a periodicity around it. We have our friends from Black Bag with us. We're going to talk all about Mac forensics, iOS forensics, stuff they're working on, tools that are being updated, tools that they're working on, things that's happening, all sorts of fun stuff. And of course, we'll also address the changes in their lives and what they're allowed to currently say. Lee Whitfield has said, I'm only here because Sarah's on. She's my hero. I mean, that makes sense, Lee. Paul says OS 10 or Mac OS, it sucks amongst yourselves.
Mac OS.
Mac OS.
So I think that's pretty affirmative there, Paul. I think it's been done. and you may remember Lee Whitfield from such things as the Forensic Forecast.
You know, although the SW understand VERS command in Mac OS still reports itself as OS X.
A lot of things do.
And as you can see behind me is tacos. Thank you, Sarah. apparently, I've been told that actually having a conference room behind me, which I had behind me for 4 years and no one had a problem with it, is now apparently boring.
Yes, well, there was never the option of tacos either.
True. So, Matthew, as always, what are you up to?
Oh, well, as you've seen, I've been playing around with some more Rust stuff. I revamped a JSON like kind of transformation tool. I had it a long time ago. I've just never really got around to revamping it. But one of the issues, I don't like to spend a lot of time on output, as you've noticed. I'm not going to give you Zimmerman GUIs. It's not a thing I'm willing to spend my time on anymore. A lot of the stuff I play around with, it all goes into Arongo or Elastic or something else. So I just want JSON. I don't care. But that makes it harder for other people to have a good time with it because they don't necessarily do that. So a lot of my current listening tools that I've been playing with, I have the event log listener out there now, the USN listener. We finished up the MFT listener not too long ago. And that just all helps you kind of see what's happening with these forensic artifacts in real time as you perform actions. But the downside is all of that output is in JSON, which no one wants to go through. So I don't know, like I deal with JSON all the time. Just a lot of the tools I use now give JSON as output. I like it. Cowen and I have done all sorts of presentations in the past about how you correlate artifacts, and generally a lot of the data that you need for that correlation isn't always in the tool output, because when a tool goes to parse a very nested data structure and it gives the user flat text output like CSV, it's hard to make these very nested data structures into linear form, and sometimes when you do that you leave data out. And we like a lot of the data that gets left out occasionally because it allows us to do some really cool artifact correlations that otherwise you wouldn't be able to do. Needless to say, generally, when you get that data back, it's got to be in some type of nested form to show its true natural form. But nasty to go through. So I made a cool, I play with a lot of tools like, what is it? JQ. JQ is a common tool for filtering and reformatting JSON data. My favorite is JMES Path. I like it because it's got Rust libraries, Python libraries, .NET libraries. Like, there's a library for pretty much every language for using this specification of JSON query language. Very helpful for dealing with a lot of data that's in JSON. So if you're even results that are coming out of something like Arongo DB or Elastic, generally you're going to want to do something with that. I mean, pretty much any NoSQL solution, Mongo would be the same way, right? So the idea is can I have a stream of JSON and be able to filter it and reformat it on the fly into something like text? And that gives you the ability to say, hey, I only want these certain fields, and I only want documents that contain these specific values. So one of the examples that I did was I wanted to be able to listen to the USN Journal. I wanted to run a specific tool on a specific file entry, and I wanted to see what that left behind in the USN Journal. Because what's nice about this is whenever you go to parse these artifacts with whatever tool you want, you can use Zimmerman's tool, you could use a TZ tool, you could use some Rust tools, you could use any tool, doesn't matter. That's what you're going to be seeing in that tool output. So if you want to recognize, okay, what does it look like? Or if I saw this pattern, could I be able to say, hey, this matches a tool pattern that we know of? So that's kind of the goal here, but be able to do it in a much easier way to read that output coming out of those listener tools that I made. So it just gives you the ability to filter JSON on the fly and transform that JSON into text output. So it looks prettier. I thought about doing a demo, but here's the thing. We've got really cool people on today, and they have a lot to say. So maybe I'll wait till the next episode to do that. Or if everyone just gets super bored by the end of the show, I could show off something. But otherwise, we can show it off another time. So yeah, that's about it. It's all about that data transformation, making things easier to read. Oh, and I have plans with Zimmerman. We might be in the works of trying to have his GUI take in the output from my tool via named pipes. So that's something we're working together on. So hopefully that'll come out sooner than later.
Mm-hmm. Well, have you come up with a name for your collaboration? Like,
Easy Beard. I don't know. I haven't really thought about it.
All right. So now let's go. Let's see. I think the proper order here is to start with the person who is probably authorized to provide the most official statements, and that's Ashley.
Thanks.
So for those who do not remember, Ashley Hernandez, who has been on the show multiple times in many roles, she's back, and she's here this time in her capacity. What is your title today? I don't want to. So, last time it was product manager.
Yeah, I just say director of product. I'm okay. Over product and marketing, so a little bit of both of those.
Very cool. So a lot going on in your life, in your world, simply within the world of Black Bag. Where do you want to start?
So I think we wanted, you know, there was a couple of questions that came in right away about the Celebrite acquisition. So we'll just get those out of the way, and then we'll talk about, you know, how we're excited to move forward this year. So Celebrite did acquire Black Bag, but we are a wholly owned subsidiary. So we're still Black Bag, still all the people you know and love and work with. And our products are staying the same. So we put out an announcement just kind of making sure people know Blacklight, Macquisition, Mobilize, all those are still as they are. And we are continuing to be committed to our roadmap that we had, but we're excited to be able to join forces with Celebrite. So internally, I know I can let Joe and Sarah talk about on their side what they're excited about, but we're excited to join on especially the mobile side, as Celebrite is the experts on that piece. And so we can do a lot of the artifact parsing, and people like our desktop analysis. But the great piece for me, and really a big thing that I think will make this a successful marriage, is that we're both in the same space and committed to the same people and the same mission. So when we talk to them, it's fun to be like having your own shorthand in, you know, DFIR world. You can say the same words and they get the because they're in the same space. So it's really helpful to have those conversations kind of quickly flow. Near term, we did post a blog this week about what we ingest of Celebrite formats, because I think people might have some questions about what we can just take into Blacklight. We had done a bunch of updates at the end of last year that had Celebrate updates when we did our unified log stuff as well, that we added to Blacklight 2019 R3. So that blog post is there if you're interested on what we can already bring in. But other than that, this year's roadmap is pretty much going to stay the same as if we weren't acquired by Celebrite. You know, we're going to make sure we update our formats that we take from them, but any more deep integration is going to happen down the road. And so we're going to focus on making sure you can get everything that they are able to extract into Blacklight. And then we have a bunch of other cool stuff on the horizon.
All right. Well, let's talk about current and immediate future capabilities, and let's break it down on a per product basis. Let's start with the thing that usually I harass people about the most when it doesn't work, and that's Macquisition. and it's not a programming area, it's that Apple constantly updates their hardware and
yeah.
Makes things up for everyone. What is the current state of Macquisition, and what is your immediate plans?
So Macquisition right now works on the currently released hardware that's out there. So we support full pixel images. Thank you, Joe, for T2 chips, which is a unique piece to Macquisition that nobody else has. And we introduced that last year. But Macquisition historically has focused on getting just the collection piece, right? So you did either a full disk image or you did logical collection of some preset artifacts. And for the most part, I think that was sufficient for the field. You wanted to get the data off and then you would do the analysis later. But what we're seeing is a trend of people needing to like figure out if it's the right machine or in the law enforcement space, make sure it's actually within scope and do some actual viewing of the disk before they do collection. Mm-hmm. So Macquisition, the release that's gonna come out as close to in this month as possible, no pressure on our dev team there, is that we're gonna have some new ability to view the content before you do actual acquisition. Mm-hmm. So that would look like just browsing the file system and looking at documents or pictures that you might wanna see, or some common filtering. So look across the metadata, look at dates and times, look at those pieces, down to doing keyword searches and looking at those hit results in the interface. So we gave a little sneak peek of some of that on our webinar that we have coming up in a couple weeks. There's some pictures there of what that might look like, but we are really excited to get more triage directly into the tool before you actually do acquisition. We still expect people to do analysis after they've done the collection. So any further reporting or that kind of work would be done in your regular tool. I doubt you want to build your report on the suspect's computer, but you know, to be seen. so we'll look at that down the road, but definitely focusing on, we can, with the 2020 R1 release that's going to be coming, we know we boot and do live acquisition on all of the latest operating systems and hardware. So just continuing to keep up with our support on those pieces is exciting.
Very nice. All right, so that's Macquisition. Now let's talk about Mobilize.
So Mobilize does not have any ability to do any jailbreaking. So this is where, or any sort of cracking, right? So you are pretty much locked into users providing you the password, which is great for a corporate setting or for where you have forced cooperation on the device. I'm not sure what the right term for that is. Sarah's laughing. Do you have a better one? Forced cooperation is not exactly the right.
We call them lawful search warrants, Ashley.
No, I'm saying like, you know, if the organization owns your device, you are supposed to, by signing a thing, give them the password. Anyway. So for those scenarios, Mobilize still allows you to do a triage, and in there it'll quickly give you you know, what we can see as we're doing the collection. We're doing a full collection, so it is still going to take you a bit to bring all that data down, but you can see it as you go and you can pause it where it's at. So we did update to say we supported the latest iOS releases at the end of last year or near the end of last year. And now we need to look and see what makes sense in Mobilize as far as beyond just phones that we unlock with the password. That will be a conversation I think that we'll have with the Celebrate folks. But still the ability to just triage quickly in a really simple kind of date-bound way, I think is something people like about Mobilize. So we'll see where that fits.
Very cool. And of course, the largest and most complex product that I know of, at least, that's Blacklight. So what is happening with Blacklight?
So Blacklight is where we've spent quite a bit of energy making sure you can do full desktop forensics in the last year on both Windows and Mac. So I know Vico is indisposed today, so he won't be able to talk about Windows, but we can have him join us another time. But we have been consistently updating our Mac and Windows support. So you saw unified log support, and not just pulling like one artifact out of unified logs, but really doing comprehensive pulling of the full file format and letting you filter in for any type you might know more about. And then we also added towards the middle to end of last year, Apollo support. So I know Sarah is gonna be able to talk about how we can get all the latest Mac artifacts as she rapidly updates Apollo. You get those directly into Blacklight. So those were the big major release items we did, along with all the Windows 10 artifacts that Vico added at the end of the year. So going forward, we are working on the next release, and we will have some, I think we can talk a little bit about keychain today if you'd like, Joe. So I'll let Sarah and Joe talk about some of the future things on the Blacklight side.
Cool. So those are the three major products that I know of. Is there anything else that you are allowed to talk about from your side?
I mean, at this point, we have a huge roadmap for 2020. I know I just got some kick developers butts title over on the right side there. That is part of my job. That'll continue to be me pushing to make sure we're adding things that folks need. So of course, always ping me on Twitter if you have any feedback. But our roadmap's really full and their roadmap's really full. So I don't think you're going to see more tight integration this year of any changes between the products. We have a bunch of work we want to add on our side to just do additional analysis and also to support things like having non-technical folks review case data, making that easier, tighter integrations with e-discovery products. Those are all things that are already things that we want to make sure we're doing to support not just law enforcement, but our corporate customers. Mm-hmm. So you're going to see a lot of that from us this year. And I think that, you know, we'll start to have more information about where we're going to be, you know, kind of getting more synergy with the Celebrate team over the next 6 to 9 months.
Very nice. All right. Before we move on to Sarah and the Mahalik Edwards conspiracy, is there anything else that you would like to talk about? I want to make sure that we gave you all of the time that you wanted.
No, I think I'll jump in if there's anything else, but okay. We're really excited. It's been great working with the Celebrate team. I know Heather, speaking of, has been working with them closely and enjoyed it. And they're just really smart and they know the same space we do, which is really fun to be able to talk about future plans. It's really cool.
Very cool. All right. Sarah Edwards.
Hi.
Are you ready to admit the giant conspiracy that obviously must have taken place behind the scenes, the gears within gears that led to you and Heather working essentially for the same company?
Yeah, you know, I didn't quite get enough of Heather at the Sands job, so I guess I just made things happen, and now I work Blacklight, that's a new thing, as well as Celebrite. So a lot of new stuff going on in my life right now, yeah. I don't know which company I'm with anymore, so it's all happening so fast.
So what you're saying is that you and Heather did not plan to both leave your jobs, go to two product companies that ended up merging together. Like, this was not something.
No, obviously not. It just happens to to work out. I think it's going to be great. Work really well together. We work well together through SANS, through other day jobs as well. So I guess we'll see what happens.
Other than Prosecco Fridays, what else will change?
I would love to have Prosecco Fridays. Ashley, can we get on that?
I wish I could reach off camera and make that happen right now.
I'm not going to say I don't have a bottle stashed very close to me right now. But I don't know. I guess it's just sort of like a wait and see where we can collaborate. I assume we can at some point. But, you know, who knows? I know Heather and I are already talking about what we want to present at the DFIR Summit. And, you know, we presented together for the last 4-5 years. Not even sure. And this time it'll be like more official because we're sort of working with the same companies now. So it'll be cool.
Pretty cool. All right. Where do you want to start? Do you want to start with Apollo? Do you want to start with your new role? Do you want to start with hot dogs?
Always hot dogs. I'm starving. I'm missing lunch right now because of the forensic lunch.
Same here.
These tacos are not helping. I don't know. Hit me. Whatever.
All right.
I have no preference.
Well, in that case, let's start. There we go. Let's start by talking about Apollo.
Okay. So Apollo has certainly been my pet project for almost about a year and a half now. It was originally just a proof of concept, something I wanted to whip up to help me do whatever I was doing with my other day job. And it just turned out that it's really useful information. Some of it is oddly specific and very, very detailed, kind of minutia. But sometimes when you get into investigations, that kind of level of detail really, really helps out. So I've been developing that. I've been updating it like crazy. I just did a webcast last week or this week? Just seems like forever ago. It must have been this week. about the integration of Apollo and Blacklight. So that's out there. So as Ashley said, Apollo was kind of implemented as a plugin to Blacklight. So should be able to keep updating that and having more capabilities, having more Mac specific capabilities. That's one of my goals for earlier on this particular year, is to get some more of that. You know, other things like, you know, there's some obvious misses here. You know, some of the application data could certainly be thrown into Apollo. Screen time is one that I've been working on for a while now. Screen time is complicated, especially when you got the cloud stuff going back and forth and all your devices kind of syncing into the same database. So still working on that one. So I think there's going to be quite a few updates. There's no lack of any data that's out there because Apple keeps changing it all the time.
Now, before, your research on iOS and OS X was something that you did in your spare time, and you did different research when you were at work. But now, your work life and your hobby and your SANS life are all kind of merging together. Where do you think the community at large should expect, as you know, kind of changing is what they see coming from Seyer Edwards?
Well, I think I'm doing all the same research just across the board. So I honestly spend almost every waking minute doing some sort of research. I think, you know, getting some of that implementation into Blacklight, getting it into Apollo, keeping it open source, as well as being able to present and blog and do all the things that I do to keep myself extremely busy, I think it's going to be good for the community. You know, I guess I've sort of become the Mac person, iOS person in the community. So I'd like to keep that going. I mean, some days I feel like I'm just regretting life decisions because I just have too much stuff to do. But I think on the whole, it is a good thing. I think a lot of the stuff that I was able to pull out back when I first introduced Apollo, everybody was like, what? This is stored on the device? I'm like, yeah, it's been stored on the device for quite a few years, but nobody's spent the time to really dig into it. And that's one of the things I love. I love finding that one weird little artifact that might, you know, help an investigation. It might unravel a whole investigation.
Very cool. So Apollo is kind of the focus of your current research. Is there, without giving away any future talks you may be working on or things you're doing, what else out there is drawing your interest?
I've been doing a lot of, and I've already done this talk, so it doesn't really matter. I've been doing a lot of just talks on how do I do research? Because it turns out people just never jailbroken a phone before, never gone on there, never, was doing live SQL queries while testing their devices. I run with my devices. I have my watches. I have test data, so I'm wearing watches on two wrists now because I'm that person. So it's all a matter of data population, trying to find real life data. You can only fake data so well, especially when it comes to things like location and, a lot of the cellular information. You have to get out there, you have to create it, and you have to analyze it. So I think that's really one of my things, is teaching people how to do what I do.
That makes sense to me. So we talked about Apollo, we talked about your new job, we've talked about new research. Let's talk about SANS. Let's talk about your class. It seems like, from the secret back rooms that we're in, that your class is ramping up in people's interest and expectations. What's new in 518?
Well, that's, I leave tonight to a red eye to London. So it's going to be my first class that I've taught in quite a while. I had this nice little kind of sabbatical for about 4 months between jobs. I took 2 months off. I took a crazy vacation. It was fabulous. So it's time to get back into the grind. I've updated the class. I've added some stuff. I even might go rogue in London and introduced some new stuff that's not officially part of it yet, but yeah. Hopefully some APFS parsing in there, if I can make that happen. So yeah, I'm off to London in a few hours. It's going to be great. It's one of the largest European classes that I've had. So I'm really, really looking forward to it. London is also one of my favorite cities to go to.
I agree. Let's see. Just trying to make sure I'm not missing something. Talked about 518. You're going to be presenting, probably most likely be selected again for the summit.
Maybe.
Put
Let's
my
see.
Kreskin hat on.
I'm speaking at Objective by the Sea
Oh, there you go.
in Maui, Patrick Wardle's conference. Could pick worse places than Maui, but it's a great opportunity to get with, kind of more of the security community. And I'm going to be talking about Apollo there. I'm actually going to be bringing my sister out, and she's going to be doing visualizations of Apollo data with me. So hopefully, getting some pretty pictures out of there. We don't know quite how it's going to work yet, but I think that'll, kind of be a nice little teaser to the investigators to see. We can look at this data in a CSV or a SQLite output, but once we actually visualize it, I think that's a whole different ballgame.
And then one last question, unless you have something else you want to talk about, and that is for the other people out there that have been in a governmental to quasi-governmental role for as long as you were, and then you have made the leap of faith into the private sector, what would you tell someone else in that role who was considering doing the same?
Well, it was tough. It was kind of a big decision, but I feel like I can make a better, a better impact globally than I can with what I was doing in some of the government that I was doing before, government work. So I hope to be able to do that. It's kind of weird. This is also my first work from home position, so I am wearing sweatpants right now. And I am loving that. My commute's only a few feet away. And in DC, that is amazing. So yeah, it's
Is
kind
kind
of
of
weird,
amazing.
but it's I'm loving it. I really am. I thought I would be too much stuck at home, but I try to get out to the gym every day. I try to maybe grab lunch or do some errands here and there, but no, it's been great.
Very cool. And then the off-color comment you made was that maybe you could be a regular on the show. So
I couldn't do that before,
that's
but
right. So if that's something you're interested in, we'll
sure.
take you up. Yes. Yes.
Why
Excellent.
not?
Why not? It's the right answer.
I'll just put pants on. That's fine.
Why would you do that?
Yeah,
All right. That leads us to last but not least, the doctoral committee of Black Bag. headed by one Dr. Joseph. Doctor?
Well, hello.
How Mister? Are you?
I'm doing well.
That's right. Mister, not doctor.
Not yet. I'm still trying to convince you to come over to UNO. We'll work on that problem.
Does it involve roast beef po' boy?
Many, many, many po' boys. Yes. Yes. You got to go with the surf and turf, which is the fried shrimp po' boy mixed with the roast beef po' boy, and you get the best of both worlds.
Brian Moran, if you're listening to this, we both need to go enroll in the doctoral program, and then we're going to die from eating surf and turf po' boys.
That might be enough for me to do a PhD, too. Just go for the food.
Doctor, where should we start? Yeah. What do you prescribe?
Oh, well, I think the vast majority of my life in the past few weeks has been overwhelmed with researching restaurants in Tel Aviv. But I have not been, and I would like to. No, I've been working on some cool stuff. Not a lot of it am I allowed to divulge yet, but a lot of work went into this new release and acquisition, which is going to be really cool. Mostly stuff on the back end from me, but you will see some changes. We will support a wider variety of, let's say, unstandard configurations of systems with T2 chips. So systems with multiple containers and where people have done weird things like erase the first few bytes and then install partition at a weird offset. And one of those, why would anyone ever do this? But of course you've got, when you have so many customers, you've got a significant subset that are going to come up with every weird problem. Mm-hmm. So we've got those worked out. Working on some academic work for publishing. Like to kind of bring up some discussions about how we handle hashing in forensics.
Really?
Yeah, because we do hashing for everything, right? But there's a lot of academic work in different methodologies of hashing. But when you think hashing, people think linear hash, right? Hash from the first bit all the way to the last bit in order, and that's what you got to do. I'm starting to see that that's one not fitting with what our evidence looks like anymore. Look at, use APFS as an example, look at fusion containers. Fusion container is logically the address space. The first byte is at address 0, and the last byte is at address 4 exabytes plus. So try to hash all of that stuff, and you have a very large, obviously, most of that 4 exabyte is a very large unmapped block in the beginning, in the middle. But you can't do a linear hash on that. Similarly, when we're doing our acquisition methods are changing. Out of order acquisition. Mm-hmm. We can't do in order linear hashing while we're doing that. So I think we need to start promoting a lot of these alternative hashing techniques that still give us the same guarantees and everything else like that, but that will be more efficient and actually fit our evidence better.
Interesting.
There's some techniques out there that you can use using things called Merkle trees and things like that to hash in parallel, right? Because hashing is a very synchronous, start from the first bit, go to the last bit. Now you're getting disks that are 4 terabytes larger and they're going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. It takes a lot of time. So parallel hashing algorithms. I think we need to be promoting these things. And from the vendor side, when we're using some of these techniques, we need to come up with a standardized way among all tools of denoting what kind of hashes we're using, right? Don't just put MD5, because if we used one, it's a variant of MD5, but if we didn't do a linear hash, you want to make sure these hashes can be compared among tools. So, yeah, that'll be some talks for me, hopefully at the end of this year on that, maybe a paper.
When we had to kind of overcome that, even with the AFF4, I don't know if you want to talk about a little bit about what's changing for Blacklight and acquisition on.
Absolutely. That's kind of what spawned this problem in my head is some of the confusion, right? So acquisition right now, the current release version of acquisition, not the one that's coming out any day now. We do hash the image, but what we do is AFF4 is in the AFF4 container itself, and then we hash the container. And one, we can't do that inline. You have to hash it after we create the image, so it takes longer. But two, if you would image the same target twice in a row, you would get different hash values because of the metadata that was stored inside of the image, because we weren't hashing logical data. In the new version of Macquisition, we've moved over to what I'm calling like a data integrity hash, where again, we're doing sparse out of order acquisition. So it doesn't allow us to do a linear hash of the logical like evidence in line. But what we can do is we can just hash the data as we're adding it to the image. Mm-hmm. And that way, anytime you have this reproducible hash of an image, it's still guaranteeing the integrity of the data in the image itself. Mm-hmm. But it's faster because you don't have to spend your time hashing all of these zero blocks that you're not even putting in the image. And it'll be reproducible.
Right.
But again, if you bring that to another tool that's going to calculate the linear hash over the entire image, you're going to get a consistent hash, but it's going to be a different hash than this data hash. So I'm trying to figure out ways of educating and better communicating the differences of these hashing techniques so that people just don't think that their tools are broken.
And that would be like, you know, the first assumption, right, is that the tools are broken or that something is wrong, or I hashed it or imaged it again, I got a different hash. I think a lot of this for me comes down to the misperception people have of what the hashes actually represent. You know, it's not the contents of the drive, it's what you got off the drive.
And when we're doing things like with a physical, so again, it's now our acquisition stuff is sort of, it used to be like, okay, a physical image you would think of as the bytes exactly as they exist on disk, even though that's not actually how they exist on disk, but that's what you're saying, what the bytes that exist on disk when we're reading it, the operating system gives us. But when you're having to do things like, you know, decrypt that data first, or it's useless, I mean, again, you're still getting a hash, but it's not going to be the exact bytes as they're stored on the disk, it's the hash of the data that you're pulling off of the disk.
Right.
And so we need to have those discussions, and we need to make people aware of them so they're not thinking that, oh, just because you're doing this thing, it's not forensically sound for some reason.
Well, and I
think part of that is going to be going into peer-reviewed papers and stuff, just to, so if someone has to testify in court that, yeah, this method's sound, that lends a little bit of credibility to it.
And I think a lot of people forget that we used to rely upon CRC checksums.
Oh, yeah, of course. But, and people,
literally,
you know, it's very difficult to understand, like, the levels of abstraction that are already built into your hard drive. Like I said, the bytes you're reading off of that hard drive, that's not what's stored on the drive physically. There's a lot of out-of-band data and stuff like that that is hidden from you. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, and the other thing we're adding to Macquisition is actually the ability to export to the NCASE logical evidence file format, LO1 format. So those do store logical hashes of every file, the content, not the slack, of every file you extract. So it's kind of the same idea of like, we've moved from, you know, you always take a full disk and you just try and hash it because it wasn't encrypted beginning to end, no big deal. Now it's like, well, sometimes you're taking the data off of an encrypted drive, sometimes you're taking just the files. We still need to be verifying integrity, but there's now just going to be different methods depending on the type of solution you're approaching.
Yep.
Yeah, we need to move the industry from, hey, we have to hash every single bit on the drive because that's what we've always done, to understanding why we're hashing in the first place and demonstrating that we can still give those same guarantees by using different methods.
Yep. And I'm guessing that probably the right forum for the discussion of this is maybe DFRWS?
Yeah. I kind of pitched some of this for the Australia version of DFRWS, but we'll see. But yeah, that's definitely going to start off in the academic setting. Probably be doing some blog posts, probably discussing more of it on the forensic lunch.
Excellent.
And then we can have a discussion as a community. Because yeah, it's got to be a larger thing than just BlackBag, because we need interoperability between tools. If I acquire some point Macquisition, I don't want to just be able to validate that in Blacklight. I want to be able to validate it in all of our tools, right? Any tool I use, I may use.
Exactly. And if any of you are having like a reaction right now, like, oh, Joe, that could never happen. You don't understand. Joe understands, because you don't understand what the history of our industry has been and how strange things have occurred in our industry between different tools and our inability to reproduce things between certain tools. And we've all gotten better and moved along. And the state that you have entered in, if you've recently entered in, where everything just seems to work and everybody gets along for the most part, is after years and years of people arguing over what was right and, no, you can't know how I do this, but you can use my tool to reproduce it kind of stuff.
Yeah. And I'm happy with some of the work that we've done in promoting open image formats like AFF4. Sort of had to twist a lot of arms to make this happen, but if people want to analyze physical images on Mac right now, the only way they can do it is in AFF4. So now all of a sudden, all your favorite forensics tools support this open image format. So that's a good thing. Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely a good thing.
It's a very good thing, especially, you know, because we've talked about AFF4 before. Matt and I are big evangelizers of AFF4. I wouldn't say that we are in any way related to the underlying work that you guys have been doing, but there's definitely...
Oh, yeah. No, and I'm very much in the next year hoping to work with Brad and Michael and finally formalize the logical spec so we can have a logical image format that it's not in case proprietary format.
And so Vic, okay, go ahead, Matt.
Oh, I was going to say, we absolutely use AFF4, and I love it. In fact, Bradley's helped us out quite a bit with a lot of the stuff that for.
Yep.
But I'm very interested in this parallel hashing stuff. Actually, like everything you talked about, I'm just like, it's funny because I was like, I would absolutely go to a talk that was just for those type of things. And yeah, like the data you pull out, like I think maybe one of the things that everyone that's watching would see this directly impact them is the USN Journal is a great example of sparse data. Mm-hmm. But a lot of tools, you know, export out that sparse data, which is data that doesn't actually exist, and they end up with these, you know, 52 gig size USN journals. And they wonder why the tool process is so slow. And you look at it, and it's all zeros, right? Up until the very end.
You're hashing or you're carving on data. Like our image formats know where that unmapped data is. But if you're if you're doing a linear hash, you have to hash what?
Right.
And again, what are you hashing? What do you read in when there's something unmapped? Historically, most tools read in zeros.
Yep.
But I mean, that's just because that's what we do.
Right.
So we need to discuss those things. And I mean, evidence form types have been around forever. What if you want to hash a address space, a 64-bit memory address space of a process? You're not going to be hashing 2 to the 63 bits, right? Like it's just not gonna happen. So we need to understand that there are ways of doing this that doesn't, let's just read everything in one serialized way and produce a hash.
So two questions for you, Joe. One, the first is from Vic Chester. He says, how important is hashing for SSDs due to trim and wear leveling?
Well, I think that, again, that goes back to what are we hashing for and what are our expectations? 10 years ago, we might have been, okay, we're going to, I think the standard procedure was like hash the data on the drive, read the data from the drive, write it to an image, hash the image, and then hash the data on the drive again to make sure that everything meets up. So you wind up reading everything at least three times. Now, not only is that impractical and you don't need it because you can do things like hashing as you're imaging, but the data on the drive might change the next time you plug it in just because trim gets enabled. Mm-hmm. So this expectation of the data that we are collecting from that drive needs to be the same as the drive for as long as it's in our safe is not reasonable in some cases and not possible in others. So if you're really just concerned on the most important thing about hashing is integrity, right? We want to make sure that when we've done our forensic process, nothing we did, none of our tools have changed the data.
Well, and this is where the definition becomes important, the data collected.
The data collected, exactly. And yes, ideally, you want to make sure that the data you collected is a reasonable representation of the data on the disk, but it doesn't always mean that the data on the disk isn't going to change even if you don't plug that disk into a computer.
Yep. So, Vic, I think what we are both agreeing on is that it's still important to hash, but not because of the underlying technologies that are changing the things within your SSD. It's because it's the data we extract from SSD. We want to be able to show that that data hasn't changed. And that's what it's always been about. It's never been about showing that the underlying system hasn't changed. That's what write blockers and all the other technologies are for. Hashing's about data integrity. Mark McCurdy says, linear hash checks to compare directory copies of terabyte-sized files doubles the wait time.
Oh, it exactly. But now, if you could, you've got these computers with 32 cores in them that can read really fast, and we're using one core to read one byte at a time because that's what the hashing algorithms require. So you can do these Merkle trees. You know, we don't have to get into all of it, but basically, what it works is you can parallelize it, and you hash blocks, and each of those blocks have hashes, and then you can concatenate those hashes and hash the hashes. So then you still have at the end one reproducible, verifiable hash. But you're able to multiprocess the data. You just, and again, it's not like we're going to invent new hashing algorithms. You can still use MD5, SHA-1, whatever. It's just the how you're applying these proven cryptographic hashing algorithms to generate your final hash, and then how you're going to verify them that's what we need to discuss.
Yes, and Vic's asking, so it's more important to hash the data collected. Vic, you're only ever hashing the data you collected. That's the thing, right?
It's all you can do.
Yeah, it's all you can do. And a lot of times that can get confusing based upon how we talk about things, describe things, and product literature and the rest. But the only thing you've ever been able to hash is what you get out of a system.
Yeah, and honestly, like, certain vendors or vendors as a whole or the entire industry, a lot of times in their marketing, they send a bad message on that sort of thing. Like,
except this isn't worse.
I think we have a wonderful marketing team. But I won't say anything more. It has been a thing that in the past, people in the industry have stated, no, if you're not doing this, then you're somehow not making evidence. This is not going to be admissible in court because you're not doing this. And I just can't see that that's true.
I would agree. I would absolutely agree. Let's see. Brett has decided to, chime in with, large words. The method type of hashing should be based upon the totality of the circumstances, the reason, objectives for the hash, and decision of the analyst. Brett, I agree. And those
he's are, right. Yep. He's absolute. There's no, well, I'm not saying there's one thing that we all should move to. There are multiple techniques that we should be employing. But what we all need to move to away is how to identify within our tools what technique we use to hash. Mm-hmm. That way other tools can use the same technique to verify those hashes.
Yep. Mark saying that you should just use blockchain. It's the answer, just like CBD oil. And Paul said, at the end of the day, is it more important to document your process for imaging versus the nuances of hashing? Paul, I think the difference here is that what Joe's getting to, excuse me, Dr. Joe is getting to, is that it's important that not only do you document what you've done, but that other tools can recreate what you found for validation.
Right.
All right.
I don't want my acquisition tool to report one hash.
Yep.
And then when you pull it into your analysis tool, whatever the analysis tool may be, it should report the same hash because it should know what did the acquisition tool do to generate the integrity hash.
Exactly right. Well, Joe, so we've talked about that for a second. That's gotten people's interest.
Well, that's good. So now I hope my talks will be accepted. It seems like it's a...
What about DFRS and DFRWS in Memphis coming up?
Yes, DFRWS in Memphis is coming up. I'm once again the workshop chair, which we are still open for solicitations. So if I think I already bugged Matthew about submitting something, which I haven't gotten anything from yet. But generally, there's general interest. If you want to put together a workshop, 2 hours or 4 hours, if you really want to do like an all-day thing, we might be able to make that happen too. One of the perks. We usually give one free entry to the conference for someone who wants to put on a two-hour workshop. We put on a four-hour workshop in the past, and I'm sure it'll be the same again. And you have two people putting the workshop together. We could probably let you both in for free.
Right on.
I've done the workshops. It's a really great experience. The first time I ever went to DFRWS was with a workshop, and I really enjoyed it.
And if you've never been to DFRWS, and was that your first? I guess you just said it was your first DFRWS, and I think Matt and Dave went to their first DFRWS recently.
Awesome.
It's different. Mm-hmm. It's a very different experience than something you might get from like a DFIR summit or SDF con, because it is an academic conference. Jessica's done a wonderful job in expanding the outreach to industry. So we do now have a fair bit of industry representation, which I think is a good thing. We need to stop having this separate like academic world plus practitioner world, because both sides of the field, we do better when we collaborate. So yeah, I would encourage you to go. And plus it's Memphis. I mean, we're going to eat some barbecue. It'll be good.
It's true. Now, there's only one bad part, and this is the only reason I think I might not be able to go, which is that I believe that it coincides with the week of training after the DFAR summit.
Ah, well, I blame Rob.
And maybe I'm wrong, but I think I remembered, like, I was trying to remember what it was that was where I thought I was going to be able to go, and then Jessica reminded me that it was the same week as the same summit.
Well, not the summit, but
well, yeah, the training. After. Yeah. Let's see. So we talked about that. Let's talk about your program at UNO that you're currently, I mean, I believe you're in your classroom now, right?
Well, I'm not in my classroom. I'm in my Louisiana State Prison cell.
Oh.
it's in my office. UNO's going fine. Still adjuncting over here. I'm teaching two classes this semester. I'm teaching a graduate level penetration testing course. Should be, you know, it's fun. We've got a new cool lab environment here set up to where almost everything is virtualized, sort of thin clients, so students can go into the lab. They still have physical access to the lab 24 hours and log in, but we also have something, we're using Apache Guacamole, which, yeah, sorry, Matt, people use the Guacamole name already. You're going to have to sue those guys. But that basically allows them to get access to a virtual lab environment from basically anywhere in the world, so that's cool. So I'm hoping to kind of expand some trainings that way, so maybe we can have remote students. Mm-hmm. And I'm also teaching a graduate and undergraduate, it's a kind of a dual enroll course, Introduction to Forensics.
Nice. Now, all of your classes currently require on-site enrollment, right? There is no remote attendance.
That is accurate, but most of my courses now are becoming heavily lab-based. Mm-hmm. And with our new lab setup, like I said, the semester's only 3 or 4 weeks in at this point, and this is kind of the first time we've actually used it. I'm hoping that changes. Maybe we can do some sort of remote enrollment thing. I mean, it's a university, so it's not just an easy decision for me to make to do that. There's a lot of mechanisms to make that happen, but I think it is one of the goals of the department, is to try to not make it like an online class where you're teaching yourself at your own pace, but allow students who are not physically present to get the same sort of experience as the students who are physically present.
Interesting. All right.
The future, man. And then you can get your PhD without killing yourself from Po' Boys.
But both are good.
No, I recommend you just move here. But take advantage of Louisiana's 30% research and development tax credit.
I'm going to have to talk to the wife. We'll figure this out. Ashley, one thing we did not talk about, and something that I saw posted online, is that you guys are currently looking for more developers.
We're looking for developers and QA. So we are growing that team. Specifically, we're going to be looking, Joe and Vico and Sarah are so good at their jobs. We end up with lots of artifacts waiting to go into the core product. So gets into Apollo or it is developed by Vico. And sometimes we're waiting to get those in just because we need more development cycles. So we have three developing positions open, I think, and we desperately need recommendations from folks. You would think it would be easier to find people, but you know, good developers are employed a lot of times.
It's true.
At this point in life. So yeah, we all work remotely, so it doesn't matter where you're based. I think Sarah's getting used to working from home. Now that I've done it for a couple years, I don't know that I could ever go back. I'm way more productive, and also I'm a mom, so I like being able to pick up my kid from school occasionally. So Yes, developers, QA, either of those, that team is growing, and we need various skills. Some would be kind of friendly, looking at things. Some are more deeper architectural pieces. So whatever your background, it's not going to be straight like, you know, you're looking at more of an object-oriented background like C++ or something a little deeper than just Python. Sorry, did I? Yeah, did my face make a face when I said that? Sorry.
I feel like she's talking to me.
I think the reason
structures, not sorry, I know.
Ashley says it's difficult to define developers, and I think there are plenty of people who know development, and you can learn other languages. You know, you can learn the subset of languages that we use. If you know how to do development. But I think it's difficult to find people who have at least a basic background in forensics to do development, because that goes a long way into making our tools good, is when if our developers understand what the artifacts are and they're not just showing you random things that they don't know what it means.
Yeah. So. And that is the hardest part, you know, as a product manager when I'm working with developers, is I can say, like, they want, you know, go ahead and parse unified logs. But like, if they don't know why people would use them or what they're actually looking for, it's hard to know what exactly, well, one, you don't know what you're going to get out of it until you parse it. But then two, like, what are people going to want with it? So I don't always think there's going to be people who have a background in forensics, but there are people who are good at understanding what is of value when you're trying to put together the history of things or how things work together. Like, they have the methodology in their head of how you are trying to build the case for how something happened. It doesn't have to be like totally directly forensics. It just has to be ability to like see things from a user's perspective.
Okay. Right. But I would think, you know, and again, I'm not in charge of the engineering team for hiring, but there are both type of candidates should be applied.
Yes, totally. Because we have spots for
people with a lot of developer experience that are willing to learn a little bit about forensics, or people with a lot of forensics experience and a little bit of developing experience that want to learn more about development.
Yep.
Because yeah, it's rare you're going to find the person who's an expert at both, like from the start. If you unless you're coming from one of our competitors or something, and we're not necessarily trying to poach people.
Yeah.
But you should still apply.
Yeah, still try if you want to apply. We like working in Black Bag. It's been, I mean, it's definitely, we have a special team of everybody who works together and gets along, which is nice. And now that's growing.
This week, both Vico and I hit 5 years at Black Bag.
Wow, has it been 5 years already?
Yeah, in my real world life, that might be the longest that I've been with a single company. So.
That's a good sign.
I like it.
That's a good sign. And with the last 2 minutes we have, I will say that we are also hiring at KPMG. So if you would like to not be strictly on the development side, but on the forensic side, and you would like to have a balance in your life between interesting cloud, IR, normal investigation, and ransomware incident response, that's something that we can provide as well as amazing benefits. And you can work with...
So Matt, maybe... Maybe, I mean, Dave, maybe KPMG should buy Celebrate, and then we can all be one big happy family.
All be one family. There we go.
So I've been told that we are not a software company.
That's why you need to buy one.
And we will not become a software company. So, sorry, guys. I'll try again. I'll try again. But with that, the only other thing I have to say is that my co-author for the cloud forensics class for SANS has told me that I am not allowed to start a PhD program until we finish the class. So for those of you waiting, just know that, yes, we are working on the cloud forensics class, and there are many people who are pushing us to get it done. But thanks, everyone, for coming on. I think it was a great discussion. I think we got a lot of good information out. I hope everyone is understanding more about the future over there at both Black Bag, the Black Bag Celebrated acquisition, the merger, the tooling, the people, the technologies, and all the other fun stuff around it. And we hope that you'll join us in 2 weeks, because believe it or not, we actually have a show scheduled on the 21st with guests and the YouTube link already live. So next broadcast in 2 weeks, February 21st, will be the Australian episode. And I say that because everyone on will be from Australia, and so we're moving the time up to 5 o'clock to allow them to actually be able to wake up in the morning. So it'll be the forensic breakfast for them. It'll be the forensic happy hour for us. And Brett Shaver says, forensic lunch rocks. Thanks, Brett. Appreciate that. And Lee says, I'll apply to both. Don't tell Rob.
B-Sides NOLA 2020, oh. October 24th.
Oh. And
B-Sides NOLA 2020, the gateway to po' boys.
True. October 24th.
And a black bag. Thanks for coming to the odd, everyone. And we'll see you next time.